Welcome to Asbury. I'm Brother Hammett, and I'm so glad that you're with us today. As you prepare to worship with us on our live stream, I invite you to make space wherever you are for worship, if you're able. You may want to silence your devices and make yourself comfortable, maybe light some candles. Please do take just a moment and let us know that you're here. You can do that in a couple of different ways. The first way is to scan the QR code on your screen. All you have to do is open the camera on your phone or smart device and aim it at the screen, and you'll receive an invitation to open our sign-in webpage. Or you can just make a comment in the chat or like the video. If you're looking for a church home, you're always welcome at Asbury. If you'd like to visit about joining the Asbury family, just email me at the address below, and I'd be glad to work out a time when we can visit. I pray that God blesses you through this service today. We'll begin in just a moment.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Asbury. What a joy it is to be in worship with you today. I pray that this time of worship is a blessing to all of you. I'm Nick Schimmer. I'm one of the pastors here. My colleague is Reverend Hammett Evans. He'll be bringing the message today. First of all, happy Father's Day to all of you fathers that are here with us in the sanctuary, for those that are joining us online. And then, of course, it's a wonderful day to remember all those fathers that have gone on to their eternal rest. What a blessing all of you are to the kingdom, and we thank you on this day. Just a few announcements before we get started. I want to begin with attendance. We have a perforated tab now for our attendance on the bulletin, and so you can fill that out and drop it in the offering tray during the time of offertory. If you're online, there's a QR code there for you to scan to log your attendance. We're beginning a new sermon series today, and we're calling it For Freedom. And so for the next 3 to 4 weeks, we're going to be in the book of Galatians, spending some time with Paul, talking about what it means to be free with the life of Christ. A couple of great things coming up in the life of the church. Next Sunday is our VBS kickoff, and we're going to kick that off next Sunday with a food truck party. And so we will have a food truck here from 11:30 to 1. We invite you and encourage you to stay and have lunch with your Asbury family. Nicole is looking for some volunteers to show up at 9 a.m. to help set up chairs outside for that event. And so if you're able to do that, if you're able to help set up at 9 and then maybe attend the launch service, that would certainly be helpful. And then we'll also need people to help take those down. That is normally a job that we use the fine labor of the youth for, but the youth will be heading out because next Sunday is also Stone Soup Sunday, which is a blessed day in the life of our church. So many of us will be gathering at Quapaw Quarter UMC at 1:30. We invite you to join us if you'd like to help serve our brothers and sisters in the Little Rock community. So that'll be at 1:30 at Quapaw Quarter. And then the last thing that I have is just a positive report on our return from Alabama. Our youth group was there this week. I'm happy to report that all the kids we left with were the same kids we returned with, which I know the parents are very happy about. We overcame a bit of adversity. We had one COVID positive person in our group, and so that's why I have the mask on today. We had the bus in the shop for a day, so all those normal things that happen on a youth group trip. But through all that, we were the hands and feet of Christ. We came together with two other churches, one a Lutheran church and one a Baptist church. And the kids don't care about denominational stuff. They care about coming together and serving the Lord and making friends. And it was truly a special time for that. And so we thank you for your prayers and for your support during that time. Now, with all that, let's prepare our hearts and minds as we join together in worship. Thank you.
Amen. Please stand and join me for our call to worship, which is found in your bulletin. Our relationships with our fathers are complicated.
For some of us, our father's love is like God's love, too deep, too long, too wide, too strong to measure.
Some of our dads are here, some were never here.
For some of us, God's love fills in the empty spaces our fathers left behind.
All of us are shaped by the relationship or lack of relationship with our fathers.
On this day, we remember what it means to have a father or be a father. We recognize the importance of fathers in our communities. We pledge as a congregation to love and nurture the fathers among us so that they will manifest the love of God in all they do.
I invite you to remain standing and join us in our hymn of praise, When We Are Living, found on page 356 of your hymnal. Invocation, which is printed in your bulletin. Loving God, you who are our father and our mother, we thank you that you have shown us how important it is to follow your example as we grow in faith. Teach us to be obedient to your will, respecting you as children ought. Thank you for your mercy despite our disobedience. Strengthen us to stand up against the challenges of this world, honoring your name and trusting your grace. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
I want to live.
Pray. Gracious and loving God, I give you thanks on this morning as we gather as your beloved children. We've all walked through that door this morning, or we tune in online in different places, in different spaces, with different hurts and fears and concerns and different joys and praises. And for all of it, God, we know that you are with us, that you walk alongside us as our creator and our sustainer. And so we gather this morning, God, to give you thanks for all of the blessings that you continuously pour into our lives, blessings that are meant for us and blessings that pour through us to be a blessing to others. God, we thank you above all for being able to participate in this kingdom-building process you have called us to as your children. God, we pray this morning for those in our community who are hurting, for those who are lost, for those, God, who have turned away from you. God, we know that your grace is abundant, your love is unending, and we know that you are at work in all lives in a mighty and powerful way. We pray this morning specifically for Clifford Smith and for June Glazier. We pray for Fred Williams and for Barbara Clark. Pray for Megan Arnold. We pray for Joyce Dennis. We pray for Doug Chenault and for Jean Hammett. We pray for Barbara Mills, and we pray for all of the foster children here in Arkansas who are waiting for adoption. God, we know that there are so many who are not on this list, but whose names sit at the tops of our hearts, the front of our minds, and the tips of our tongues. And God, we give you thanks for all the work and your will that is being done with them, and we ask that you hold close to them with your love and with your mercy. God, we give you thanks today, above all else, for your Son, Jesus Christ, the source of where our real freedom, our true freedom, comes from. We give you thanks for all that he has done for us, for the heavy price that he paid on the cross, a price that we could not pay ourselves. We thank you for the glory and victory at the resurrection that broke us free from the chains of our sin and death. We thank you for Jesus's earthly ministry, for all the things he has taught us, is teaching us, and will teach us. And we thank you above all else, God, for the power of prayer, the ability to bring to you our burdens and our joys through your Son, Jesus Christ. And it was Jesus who taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer. We will now say it together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we move into our time of offering, we experience freedom through Christ, both through the forgiveness that we are given and the freedom that we feel as children of God to make an impact in our community. And so as we move into this time of offering, I want to remind you that it is through our freedom that we are able to give. If you're watching online, there's a QR code you can scan to learn more about the different ways you can give to the mission and ministries of Asbury. Let us pray. Gracious, loving God, what a joyous morning it is to be counted among your children. What a joyous opportunity before us that we have each and every day to make an impact in the world around us. We know that there are so many who don't know you, who don't know Jesus Christ. And so it is through our time and our talents, through our gifts and financial resources, that we can participate in the spreading of the gospel to all who need to hear it. So during this time, God, I ask that through the power of the Holy Spirit, we are moved. We are moved to participate in that kingdom building endeavor. It's in your Son's beautiful name we pray. Amen.
He is Alpha and Omega,
Please be seated. At this time, I'd like to invite Nicole Rose up, who's our Director of Children and Young Families, and any children who are among us today in the congregation for a special children's message.
Can tell me what today is. Father's Day. Is anyone doing anything extra special for Father's Day? Is anyone gonna make their dad a card? Or what I'm hearing is lots of extra chores are gonna be done, right? Maybe we're gonna cook meals for everyone today. Is that what you're gonna do? No. Well, I'm sure that you are going to spoil your dad, even if you just give him some time to kind of relax on his own. But I want to talk to you today about our Heavenly Father. What is something we could do for our Heavenly Father, for God, today on Father's Day? Can you think of anything? Pray. Mm-hmm, that's right.
Help.
Yeah? Anybody else have something? No? Well, lucky for us, the Bible tells us exactly what God wants. So I'm going to read you a scripture this morning from Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 12 and 13. And it says, "What do you think God expects from you? Just this: live in his presence in holy reverence, follow the road he sets out for you, love him, serve God, your God, with everything you have in you. Obey the commandments of God and live a good life." What do you think that that's telling us to do, that God wants us to do? What does it mean to live a good life? What do you think? Does it mean love people? Is that good? Yeah? Do you think it's good to tell other people about God? Yeah. So do you think today, it's Father's Day, we're going to spoil our dads, but do you think we should also do a little extra for God today? Yeah, he probably doesn't need us to buy him a tie or cook him a steak, right? But what he wants us to do is love each other and love him and tell other people about him. Can y'all do that today? All right, let's pray together. Lord, thank you for our dads, and thank you that you are the Father of us all. Help us to walk in all of your ways to please you. We love you. Amen.
Our scripture lesson this morning is from Paul's letter to the Galatian church. It'll be in chapter 2, be reading verses 15 through 21. "We are born Jews, we're not Gentile sinners. However, we know that a person isn't made righteous by the works of the law, but rather through the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. We ourselves believed in Christ Jesus so that we could be made righteous by the faithfulness of Christ and not by the works of the law, because no one will be made righteous by the works of the law. But if it is discovered that we ourselves are sinners, while we are trying to be made righteous in Christ, then is Christ a servant of sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild the very things that I tore down, I show that I myself am breaking the law. I died to the law through the law, so that I could live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in my body, I live by faith, indeed, by the faithfulness of God's Son, who loved me and gave himself for me. I don't ignore the grace of God, because if we became righteous through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Nick. I hope everybody understood everything that came out of Nick's mouth right then. Galatians is not the easiest book to understand, so we're going to dig into it in just a moment. I do want to say happy Father's Day. Welcome to Asbury. So thankful that you are here today and grateful for all of our dads and granddads and another dads that have helped to raise us. I do want to mention just a couple of quick things as in the form of an update. One is that this week, I don't know if you saw it in the news or not, but the Boy Scouts of America and the United Methodist Church have finally reached an agreement where we can have partnerships going ahead. And in the past, we've called that a charter agreement. The new form will be called an affiliation agreement. And we are good through the end of October. They're going to be rolling that out over the next several months. And so we're very thankful that we'll be able to continue our relationship with Troop 24. Amen? Amen. We're excited about that. I do want to give you a heads up. We have had some folks test positive for COVID in our congregation lately. We haven't noticed any spread for that, but cases are rising in Pulaski County. We went from low COVID levels two weeks ago to medium last Sunday. And we don't require masks at medium levels, but we do recommend them. And we want you to be aware of that so that you can take the precautions that you need to take as you attend Sunday school and other small groups and come to worship each Sunday. And finally, I recommended a sermon from Dr. Robbins over at Pulaski Heights last week. John Miles at First United Methodist Church in Jonesboro is offering a rebuttal. So if you want to hear the other side of that argument, you're welcome to listen to that. I think that's this Wednesday evening, and you check your social media on that so that you have both sides. I want to be very clear. As long as I am your pastor, it doesn't matter whether you're a staunch conservative or a staunch liberal or anywhere in between. You are welcome here. Amen? You are welcome here. And I want you to know that you don't have to agree with me for me to be your pastor and to love you, and so you are welcome here. So let's move on into the sermon. That was basically it. We are beginning a brand new worship series today, and it's called For Freedom. We'll be spending 4 Sundays in Paul's letter to the Galatians, and I'll say a little bit more about that in just a few moments. But today we're talking about the Father's greatest gift. And so let's begin with a word of prayer. God, we do thank you for being with us in so many ways already this morning. And we thank you now for giving us your Holy Spirit so that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, you who are our strength and our friend, our rock and our redeemer. And the people of God said, amen. I want us all to take just a moment and think about what your father's best gift to you was. What was the best gift you ever received from your father? And I'll share, while you're thinking about that, I'll share mine. Mine was actually a birthday present. It was my 17th birthday. And you may remember about a year ago when I first got here, I told a story about how I totaled my mom's car at the beginning of my senior year in high school. And if you remember that story, I may tell it again in a week or two as a part of this series. But suffice it to say today that though I did not deserve it, my dad showed me grace that day, and he offered me the keys to his car and let me drive home. Well, we were a three-car family, and now we were one car short. And so Dad and I started talking about the kind of car that I wanted. And I said, Dad, you know, I've always wanted an old Volkswagen Beetle. I always thought those were so cool, but this was 1987, and Volkswagen Beetles at that time, the original series, had been out of production for quite a while. Most of the ones that you saw were either on the side of the road blowing up or they were in a junkyard. And so I figured that I would have to wait until I left for college anyway to get a car, because I certainly did not deserve one. Well, I turned 17 just about 3 weeks after that wreck. This was in September of 87. And we had moved to Jonesboro that summer. That's right, I moved the summer before my senior year of high school. I won't complain about that anymore. But So I was working really hard to make new friends. Most of my friends were in band, and that was kind of where we bonded. So the Friday before my birthday, Friday night, we go to the football game, and some friends of mine asked me if I want to go get something to eat after the game. I said, sure. I said, that'd be great. And I did, and then they gave me a ride home. And when we pull up to the house there in Jonesboro, I noticed that there were a whole bunch of cars lined up outside on the street. And I thought, oh, my gosh, Mom and Dad are having another one of those dead-gum church meetings that they have. And I got to deal with that as I go in. Well, of course, it was a surprise birthday party, amen? And I walk in, all my new friends are in there. If you've met Luke Coop, Luke and his wife Beck have been visiting some lately. He was there. Ricky Duke might have shown up. I'm not sure. I can't verify that. He was not in the pictures, but anyway, he might have been. He could have been there. But anyway, they are. They're all in the house. And sometime Dad comes up to me and says, "Dad," he says, "son, have you looked out in the carport yet?" And I said, "No, why would I look in the carport? I came in the front door." And he said, "Well, you might want to go look out there." And so I go to the back door, and sure enough, what is there before my eyes but a 1973 Volkswagen Beetle in pristine condition. Dad had taken the time to wash it and to wax it. It shined like a baby blue diamond. And then Dad handed me the key to that car, and I climbed in. And if you ever drove one, there are instructions for starting that car. And once I got the instructions, I cranked it up, and it vibrated and shook. And in the back where the engine was, it started purring like a napping tiger. Well, I put Dad's gift to good use. I mean, I drove that car everywhere. I drove it to school, drove it to the orthodontist, to the barbershop, because I wasn't always bald. Took it on dates, drove it to my high school graduation, my first job interview I drove to in that car. I took good care of it, too. I washed it once a week. I waxed it once a month. I took out and saved the original radio. And to top it all off, I put 100 watts of pure sonic bliss in that little tiny car. Well, the reason that I used it and cared for that car so well is because I knew that I did not deserve it. I had totaled my mom's car, and it was my fault. I would have been happy to carry my brother on my back to school every day, both ways. But Dad showed me grace, unconditional love. Even though I messed up, he blessed me and gave me another chance. And that was the best part of that gift. So in our scripture reading from Galatians today, Paul tells us what the Father's greatest gift to us is. The Father's best gift. Now, Galatians is a fun read, and I hope you will, if you haven't read it this week, I hope you'll read it over the coming weeks in its entirety. It's only 6 chapters. It's real short. Well, Paul is all fired up. And one thing you may not know about this is that most scholars believe that Galatians is the earliest piece of writing in our New Testament. It's earlier than Gospels, earlier than all of the other letters and writings. So one way you can look at the New Testament is that everything else is kind of a response to what Paul says in Galatians. It's written in about 49 AD, and that's at least for 14 years, Paul had been out preaching the good news. And this was his message: following the rules does not put you right with God. Trusting in Christ does. Now, that's a radical statement, isn't it? Paul says, being a Christian is not about following a whole bunch of rules. It's about following Jesus Christ. Now, if that hasn't made you uncomfortable yet, let me spell that out just a little bit. Paul says being a Christian is not about obeying the Ten Commandments or any of the laws in the Old Testament. Paul says that it is not about being a good citizen. Being a good Christian is not about how much you go to church. It's not how much you put in the offering plate or how much you pray or how much you study the Bible. It's not how many councils or boards or committees or teams or subcommittees, God forbid, that you're on. It's not whether you drink or smoke or with whom you are intimate. Paul says that being a Christian is not about anything that you or I do. It is about what Christ has done and is doing.
Now, we need to flesh that out a little bit, don't we? And we're going to do that a little bit next week, but I want you to sit in that for a while and stew in it. Paul never takes that back. On at least two occasions, Paul went and had a conversation with Peter and the other disciples about what he was sharing. And Paul was sharing this good news with the Gentiles. Paul's people, the Jews, thought that Gentiles were bad because they didn't have God's rule book. They didn't have the Torah, the law in the Hebrew Bible. So Paul was telling the Gentiles that they did not have to follow the law in order to follow Christ. Now, he explained this clearly to Peter and the rest, that since Jesus, the Son of God, had declared us innocent apart from works of the law, there's no reason to ask the Gentiles to obey the law. Well, Peter and the others were in agreement. And when Peter ate with the Gentiles, he disobeyed the law anyway by eating food that the law prohibits. So Peter and the others decided to stay in Jerusalem. We said, we'll stay here and share the good news with Jewish folks like us, and you can go, Paul, and share it with the Gentiles. And that was their arrangement for about 14 years. Now, I wish you could say, and they lived happily ever after. But to put it nicely, the honeymoon between Paul and the other disciples did not last very long. Very soon, their Jewish converts to Christianity were going out and beginning to preach in Paul's churches. And these converts started saying, well, you know, if Paul is right, then why don't you just do whatever you want? And so they started telling the Gentiles that if they believed that Jesus was the Jewish Messiah, then they had to become Jewish if they wanted to reap the benefits of his messiahship. The men had to be circumcised into Abraham's family, and everybody had to follow the law handed down from Moses himself. Some of the Gentiles in Galatia, where this was being preached, believed these folks and began to get circumcised and began to follow the law to the letter. Well, when Paul heard about this, he was as wild as a wet cat. Amen. He fired off this letter to the Galatians. And I don't know if you've ever fired off an angry letter or an email, and you think about it later, you really did mean what you said, but you really wish that you had said it another way or given further explanation about it. Well, after the letter got around, Paul had some explaining to do. Paul always says, no, I meant what I said. But here he just doesn't quite spell it out for us and tie up all the loose ends like he does in a letter, like the letter to the Romans. So let's listen to what he says. Paul writes, "We are by nature Jews and not from Gentile sinners, knowing that one isn't acquitted by obeying the law, but rather through Jesus Christ's faith." Now, that may sound strange to our ears because a lot of modern translations get this wrong. That is not what Paul says in the Greek. We're used to hearing Paul say faith in Jesus Christ, but that is not what he says. He does say Jesus Christ's faith. The old King James Version got it right, so does the Common English Bible. The King James Version puts it this way. It says, "We are not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ." You see, for Paul, at least in Galatians, it is not our faith that matters when it comes to being set right with God. What matters is Christ's faith in God and in us. Christ's faith sets us right with God, justifies us with God, not our faith, and certainly not our obedience to the law. Faithfully, Christ went to the cross for us, not fully knowing what lay on the other side. So our faith in Christ is simply a response to Christ's faith. We no longer have to try to get God to accept us by our good behavior. There's nothing that we can do. We simply trust in what Christ did for us and accept that as a gift of God's abundant and extravagant grace. You may have heard the story that a guy named Robert Coleman told once about a little boy and his sister. The little girl needed a blood transfusion. She had a disease, and the donor had to be somebody who had recovered from that disease. Well, the doctor came and explained it to her older brother and told him that he was an ideal donor because not only had he conquered the same disease 2 years earlier, but he also shared his sister's blood type. The doctor asked the brother if he would donate his blood. And the boy thought for a moment, and then he said, "Yes, I will, for my sister." As they prepared for the transfusion, the little boy had a grin on his face, but when they put the needle in his arm, the smile disappeared. He watched his blood flow through the tube. And when it was almost over, he looked at the doctor in a very quivering voice. He said, "Now, when do I die?" The boy wasn't going to die, and he didn't, but he was willing to lay down his own life to save the life of his sister. That is the kind of faith that Christ showed us on the cross. Christ did offer his life for his brothers and sisters, for us, that we might live reconciled to God. So that's what Paul was talking about. Christ died to heal us of the disease of sin, but if the disease of sin continues, what good is the medicine? Well, Paul then says, if I'm rebuilding the things I destroyed, all that bad stuff that I used to do, I prove myself a lawbreaker. I died to the law through law so that I might live in God. I've been crucified with Christ. Now I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Now I'm living in flesh. I'm living in faith in the Son of God, the one who loved me and handed himself over on my behalf. I'm not invalidating God's grace, for if acquittal came through law, then Christ died for no reason. You see, Paul says there that the Father's greatest gift is that Christ is alive in our hearts. Several years ago, there was a newspaper article about a three-year-old girl named Katie. And Katie got the flu, and so her parents were good parents. They took her to see the pediatrician, and the doctor looks in her ears with a little flashlight thing and says, "Hey, will I find Big Bird in here?" And she said, "No." And the doctor asked her to open her mouth and say, "Ah," and asked, "Will I find Cookie Monster in here?" And she said, "No," and then went, "Ah." And then the doctor got the stethoscope out and put it on Katie's heart and asked, "Will I find Barney in there?" And she just laughed. She said, "No, Jesus is in my heart. Barney's on my underwear." You know, being a true Christian is not about what you do or what rules you choose to follow. It's about who is in your heart. It's about dying to sin and allowing the love of Christ to pour through us into the world around us, to the broken and despised and rejected. I'll close this morning with a letter that a father wrote to his daughter, Bristol, who taught him that very lesson. The letter goes like this. "My dear Bristol, before you were born, I prayed for you. In my heart, I knew you would be a little angel, and so you were. When you were born on my birthday, April 7th, it was evident that you were a special gift from the Lord. But how profound a gift you turned out to be. More than the gurgles and rosy cheeks, more than the firstborn of my flesh, a joy unspeakable. You showed me God's love more than anything else in all of creation. Bristol, you taught me how to love. I certainly loved you when you were cuddly and cute, when you jabbered your first words. I loved you when the searing pain of realization took hold that something was wrong, that maybe you weren't developing as quickly as your peers, and even when we understood it was more serious than that. I loved you when we went from hospital to clinic to doctor looking for a medical diagnosis that would bring us some hope. And of course, we always prayed for you. We prayed and prayed. I loved you when you moaned and cried. Your mom and I and your sisters would drive for hours late at night to help you fall asleep. I loved you when you were confused, when with tears in your eyes you would bite your fingers or your lip by accident. I loved you when your eyes crossed and then when you went blind. I most certainly loved you when you could no longer speak, but how profoundly I missed your voice. I loved you when scoliosis began to wrench your body like a pretzel and when we put a tube in your stomach so that you could eat. We fed you one spoonful at a time, even up to 2 hours per meal. I managed to love you when your contorted limbs made changing 10 years of diapers difficult. Bristol, I even loved you when you could not say the one thing in life that I longed to hear back. Daddy, I love you. Bristol, I loved you when I was close to God and when he seemed far away. When I was full of faith and also when I was angry at him. And the reason that I loved you, my Bristol, in spite of these difficulties, is that God put this love in my heart. This is the wondrous nature of God's love. He loves us when we are blind or deaf or twisted in body or spirit. God loves us even when we can't tell him that we love him back. My dear Bristol, now you are free. I look forward to that day when, according to God's promises, we will be joined together, completely whole and full of joy. I'm so happy that you have your crown first. We will follow you someday in his time. Before you were born, I prayed for you. In my heart, I knew you would be a little angel. And so you were. Love, Daddy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and the people of God said, amen. Let us pray. God, we thank you for loving us in the midst of all of our doubts and fears and failures. We thank you for loving us when we are broken. We thank you for loving us when we bind ourselves in the shackles of our sin and the disbelief that we can be forgiven for the things that we have done and for the things that we have left undone. God, we thank you for loving us even when we can't tell you that we love you back. Thank you for the grace that sets us free. Free from rote rule following. And free for living a life in which you reside in our hearts. And your love pours out through our hands and feet. To transform our neighbors, our family, our community, and the world around us. We pray over the next few weeks that you'll help us to understand what it truly means to be free in Christ. We pray this in his holy name, and the people of God said, amen. Let us stand together now and affirm our faith through, this is an affirmation of faith by Robert Ingram, and it's called We Are Children of God. This will be our affirmation of faith during our Galatians series. Let's join together. We are children of God. We have been water washed and spirit filled. We are dead to sin and alive in Christ. We are done with law and live under grace. Our hearts are set on righteousness. Our minds are fixed on life and peace. Suffering is nothing compared to the glory to come. For we're heirs to the life Christ is bringing. We are children of God.
Thank you.
as we remain standing, we invite you, if you're not a part of our church family already, you're welcome to do that. You may, if you're here in the sanctuary, you may transfer from another denomination or from another United Methodist Church. If you have never professed your faith in Jesus Christ and would like to discuss that with Brother Nick or me, we would be glad to do that. Just talk with us after the service or shoot us an email. If you're joining us online, if you're worshiping online with us as well, feel free to shoot me an email and get in touch, and I'd be glad to set up a time to talk with you about how to become a part of the Asbury Church family. Let's remain standing now for our hymn. It's in The Faith We Sing, which is, I believe, is in your pews on page 2140. This ended up being the perfect song, Diana. we're going to sing Since Jesus Came Into My Heart, and we'll sing verses 1, 3, and 5. Let's sing together. Thank you once again for joining us today. Next Sunday, our sermon title is No Babysitter Required. No Babysitter Required. With all apologies to my former babysitters, they deserve all the credit in the world. I do want to say thanks again for joining us. We're so glad that you came today. And would you please receive this blessing? Go forth with Christ. Okay, we'll go on. Let's go on. Go forth with Christ above you to be your guide, with Christ below you to hold you up, with Christ beside you to be your friend, and with Christ within you to give you hope, love, joy, and peace. Go forth with Jesus Christ, your Lord. And the people of God said, Amen.